Fellow Rotarians, distinguished guests, welcome to the webinar organized by the Rotary Club of Beirut Cedars. Before presenting our speaker, I would like to talk about our future events. On October 20, we have a workshop with Mr. Samir Zahil. The topic will be Leadership, Best Sacrosanct Rules. On October 27, we have Mrs. Rula Ghariyo Zahar and Mr. Jamil Tawile. They are from the Rassemblement de Dirigeants et Chefs d'Entreprise, RDCL. They will be talking about what is next for Lebanon. On November 3, we have Ms. Christiane Hajjar, Ms. Sarah Chalabi, and Ms. Ghada Ma'mari. They will be talking about mission education. On November 10, Dr. Georgette Zinati will be talking about women helping empower women, helping small business, women business in Lebanon. And on November 17, Mr. Iyad Bustani will be talking about federalism. Without no further ado, I leave the floor to the president of the Rotary Club Beirut Cedars, President Ronnie Farah. President.
Thank you, Rodolphe. Let me start by explaining for non-Rotarians joining us tonight in our meeting who we are. Rotary is a global network of 1.2 million neighbors, friends, leaders, and problem solvers who see a world where people unite and take action to create lasting change across the globe in our communities, in ourselves. Solving real problems takes real commitment and vision. For more than 110 years, Rotary's people of action have used their passion, energy, and intelligence to take action on sustainable projects. From literacy and peace to water and health, we are always working to better our world, and we stay committed to the end. Last month, the month of September, was dedicated worldwide for literacy. In this regard, our club did several actions to support education. Unveiled a plaque for Naboo Public Library, where we donated 40,000 books valued $400,000. Delivered 10 laptops to Mehitari School in Rauda to enable teachers having distance teaching. Delivered IT equipment and laptops to Beirut Annunciation College. Offered connected boards and repaired water filters at Tekeyan School. Offered school furniture for Sagesse College. Offered connected boards to Immaculate Conception School. Yesterday, our club signed a twinning with Pointe à Pitre Rotary Club in Guadeloupe. This is our first signing of a twinning, and the members, the 60 members of Pointe à Pitre will be coming soon to Lebanon as soon as we tell them that it's safe to come and enjoy themselves all over Lebanon. For now, they're going to Dubai 2020, unfortunately, instead of coming to Lebanon. Tonight, we will listen to a seasoned lecturer speaking about a persistent problem, food waste. Now, back to you, Rodolphe, to present Mr. Issam Azouri.
Thank you, President Ronnie. Before introducing Mr. Issam Azouri, I would like to inform our Rotarian and distinguished guests that they will have the opportunity during the presentation of Mr. Azouri to ask the question they want. It is very easy. They have to go down the screen. There is something written Q&A. They click on it. They put the question they want. And if somebody else has the same question, he can like this question. And the more we will have liked, the more we have a possibility that the question will be asked to our speaker. So without further ado, I will present our speaker. Mr. Issam Azouri, determined to make the world a better place for his children, Jad and Sarah, and everyone else, Issam uses his gift of communicating to advocate for road safety, accessibility for people with disabilities, and reduction of food waste. Starting as journalist in Lebanon in the mid-80s, he became a citizen of the world, working in more than 12 countries as communication advisor to ministers and international organizations. He proudly contributed to putting an end to using children as camel jockeys in UAE, concluded the protocol of the rights of students with diabetes in Qatar. He put the communication strategy to eradicate worst form of child labor in Lebanon and is passionate about inspecting dustbins in accessible toilets. He spent the last 7 years at FAO and other UN agencies, and he is advocating for the past 4 years for the reduction of food waste at consumer level. We hosted him 2 years ago with the first Rotary Acts on this topic, and he proudly presented it to other Rotary clubs in Tunisia and Cyprus. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our speaker, Mr. Azouri. The floor is yours.
I will be able to share my screen once I get the permission to do it. I'm glad to be with you on Zoom from Cyprus. And I'm very excited about this event. Okay, I think we got it now. And thank you. The topic I'm going to speak about today is controlling food loss and food waste in Lebanon, not from a agriculture perspective or from economic value, but mainly as a national duty and a personal action. And I really count on your personal behavior to make the change that we are all looking for. To put things in perspective, we're talking about something that the whole world agreed on in September 2015, when the UN General Assembly adopted the 2030 agenda with its 17 goals. What concerns us today is the target 12.3, which is the indicator related to the food loss and waste. We have, the world has pledged to have the per capita global food waste at retail and consumer levels by 2030, and to reduce food loss at the production and supply chain. Don't worry about technical terms. It might be the only technical term I'm going to use during this quick session. And this is a global thing because we cannot afford to continue living at the same pace. Just remember, 2030 is 9 years away. And if we want to talk about harvest seasons, we only have 9 harvest seasons left. The UN Secretary General just supported us with this tweet on the 29th of September. 29th of September is the second year that FAO has an observance of the International Day on Awareness on Food Loss and Waste. And Mr. Guterres was specifically tweeting about this and saying that we have 14% of food produced globally each year is lost and 17% is wasted. And this will have a disastrous impact on our planet at all levels. He said that we must do better, but actually he was specific that we all have an important role to play in reducing food loss and waste. This is the global perspective. And the Director General of FAO, Mr. Kyu Dong-Yu, said that FAO created with UNEP and other agencies, Food is Never Waste Coalition. And in June, the FAO Council agreed on the voluntary code of conduct to reduce food loss and waste at country levels. He was clear that we must promote awareness about this topic and initiate actions in a creative way in all directions throughout the year. And this is one of the things I try to advocate for as much as I can. And he's calling for educating the children and the youth about the food as a product of a lot of work, a lot of labor, a lot of energy, a lot of resources used in producing it, and that we must respect this. Food is never waste. It might be the first time in a Rotary club that we are producing this video, we are playing this video, which was just released on the 29th of September at the UN General Assembly and at the International Day. It is a high level message, and I hope that you will get the message very clearly.
Food is never waste, and food should never be lost or wasted. Now is the time to join forces, tackle multiple SDGs, transform our food systems. Please join us in preserving the costly value of food for everyone on this planet. Food is never waste.
Around a third of all the food that is produced around the world is either lost or wasted each year. This is equivalent of 1.3 billion tons of food. This equals to more than $1 trillion every year. A huge waste of nutritious food, healthy lives, happy children, and economic value. How can it be that we waste so much food when 1 in 10 people go to bed hungry every day?
We have to realize that for food to be produced anywhere in the world, a high amount of natural resources is needed. Land and water and energy. 10% of global greenhouse gas emissions. All for food that never makes it to the plate.
Household food waste is a global problem, not just an issue in developed countries. Consumers can try to minimize waste by only buying what they need and using what they buy. Most important is to be aware of the value of food.
Farmers lose too much of the value of their crop. Better technology, storage, cold chain, and technical assistance can help to make our own families food secure and to preserve the work of our own hands.
Investment in reducing food loss and waste makes value chains more efficient and therefore improves the business case. Reducing food loss and waste is a bankable proposition.
It is difficult to see how we could achieve meaningful transformation to more sustainable food systems without reducing food loss and waste. That is why the United States strongly supports the Food is Never Waste Coalition.
We must reduce food loss and waste. Sweden has developed a new method for measuring food losses in primary production and in the food industry. It will provide more knowledge and information on how we can reduce food loss.
Food loss and waste reduction is a triple win. More food of better quality, better use of our resources, and better environment. In order to achieve this, we need to work together and to build a multi-stakeholder partnership with data, skills, innovation, science, and the involvement of all the players along the agri-food systems. Now it's time to combine our efforts and support a transformation to achieve this triple win. Let's work together.
Thank you. This was like an international panel speaking about the topic. This was the intro, but this was the heart of the topic. It might be a habit now to see these type of words, these type of headlines. I try to be balanced in choosing the cities and the countries so that, and I apologize beforehand if any city is missing from this quick clip search. We found headlines in about finding expired food products in Dunniye, Hazmiye, Saida, Zahle, Naash, and Uzay. But what was really the trigger of this meeting is that day when I saw this news item on in Al-Nahar on 15th of June, and I talked to President Farah and Mr. Kaldani, And I told them, I think we need to have a session about this and to see what are the best practices in the world or near in the region and what can we do. It's our country and we must do something. This is an example of what other countries are doing. In Saudi Arabia, there is a law that when they found someone selling expired products, the court takes a decision, they pay a penalty. And what's more important than the penalty, I believe, is that the naming and shaming, so that they have to publish this judgment in two local newspapers. And it's supported as well by the Consumer Protection Association in Saudi Arabia, which was the entity that put this on their Twitter account and other social media. Surprisingly, and it's not a surprise because in Lebanon, I believe we have all the laws that we need. We have a solution. In 16 June 2020, we had a bill from the parliament. It's called the law of motivating the donation of food. It came after long discussions that I was part of remotely, and I know many of you, maybe those who like to speak would say about it. They were kind of advocating to get this law because to enable those who want to donate food to be able to do it. But the problem is that we're not doing it. The question is why we don't implement it. Very easy. First of all, there is kind of ambiguity in enforcing this law. Everybody tries to look at it from a different angle. There is a lack of governance. There is no entity that was given the task of making sure that this law is applicable. And I would really suggest that some group of people create some kind of an NGO to look at this, kind of a watchdog to see if this is implemented and not. There is kind of mistrust, unfortunately, because some say, oh yes, if you have products that you're not selling them, you say that you are going to get rid of them so you can gain on the VAT, which I believe isn't a very accurate reason. And there is a word I don't like to use usually, so I replace it by irresponsibility. Some people say instead of going to a warehouse to inspect what they are supposed to be donating, because this is what the law says, I just say I didn't go, I didn't have to go, so that a product that's supposed to be donated 2 months before expiry stays in the warehouse 3 years. In some cases, 3 years after the expiry date. It's a crime, it's not a scandal. So I'm not here to give anybody any lecture on what to act, but I want to say there is a quick fix for that. First of all, forget the law in terms of the terminology and specificity of the legislation items related to it, related to the tax deduction and TVA and everything, these details. Try to overcome the procedures because the law, the spirit of the law is to donate food. It is to motivate people to donate food. This is the name of the law. Everything else is a procedure. Look at the big picture. And the sad truth in the big picture today is that the Lebanese people are suffering. We are having very alarming numbers, not only about hunger and famine, but about malnutrition. And malnutrition will create diseases, and diseases need to be treated, and we don't have the medicine for that. For many people, the three meals a day is something from the past, and it's a luxury or it's a dream. I ask everyone involved in any type of business related to food, I want them to be smart, be proactive and be creative. try to see how you can spare the food from being thrown in the landfills and the dustbin. Even if you lose money, even if this is not the law, even if nobody will blame you. And if you want some motivation, I tried to put together some elements that will help you look at this from a different angle. Consider what you do as your CSR, your corporate social responsibility, instead of getting your employees on a Sunday to clean the beach or to clean the houses or to, I don't know what to do. I think the most important CSR needed today is to provide people with food. Especially I'm talking about the food that's nearly near the expiry date. You can consider it as a charity, even at a personal level, and you can write it in your books as a charity. You can consider it as a civic action if you have a civic spirit that's, and I'm glad that now we are around like 33 people participating. So at least starting with you, we can spread this message. I know we were supposed to be 100, but part of our problems is the internet, lack of internet. But by the way, I said I will be sending you your the presentation and the links to the organizers, and anybody who would like to see it alone, they are free to do it. You may consider it as an act of resistance if we want these people to survive. This is our country, it's our people. And if you really want to boost about your patriotism, you can do it as well. I mean, choose any of these five elements and say that I'm donating food because of this. You don't need to tell me why are you doing it, but just do it. What can you do? A very, very direct approach. Start with your own employees and their families. You can give your employees the food that's near expiry date, because usually as a practice, companies, they take food off the shelves that are near expiry date 3 months, I think, before the expiry date, and then they find a way to get rid of it. If you give it to your employees and you give them any quantity that they can consume, like in 1 or 2 weeks, and tell them, try to give them to every family, to their parents, to their relatives, or whoever they trust, but tell them, I mean, make sure they don't stay beyond that date. Then we can save tons of food from the landfills in Lebanon. You can donate to high traffic institutions. High traffic means the institution that offers 3 meals a day, and they have a big number of people there, like elderly shelters, orphans, restaurants of the poor. You know, we have many of these products of this institution there, and they need a lot of food. They consume a lot. I remember once in an elderly shelter, there was a donation, and the sister in charge of the place, she said, yes, it's good to have 20 boxes of processed cheese, but actually 20 boxes of processed cheese are enough for 3 nights. So just see the volume of that. And I will never forget one person who's running a restaurant for poor people. He was telling me, please try to get me the expired processed cheese, because the people I feed, they will be happy to have something on their bread, even if it's expired processed cheese. We may not recommend this from a health perspective, but we can go around it. And I ask you all to encourage youth initiatives, even if they don't have their well-structured NGOs and organizations, because they feel helpless facing this situation and they're trying to do something. And I really thank everyone who's encouraging them. And I ask you to support active and credible NGOs. It's very rare to use the word credible next to NGO, but it's one of the sad realities that we are seeing in Lebanon. I'm not going to take a lot of your time. I'll just finish very, very soon. First of all, This is the initiatives done by, I'm a proud father of Sarah, who studies nutrition at university in Lebanon. A group of her colleagues decided to create their own campaign, their own action actually against hunger. They called it Don't Waste Food, Share It. And they actually went to supermarkets and shops to get these items, distribute them. I should say that most of them usually don't go to supermarkets to buy the grocery for the house, but doing it for the poor is already a civic action. They take these products, they gave them to needy people, explain to them the nutritious value of what they're giving to them and giving them the best advice to use it wisely and quickly. And they even gave them tips about how to work on, how to deal with whatever leftovers or products that they cannot consume as raw, like the tomato. I know the tomato is a fruit, but I'm wise enough to know that I don't use it in a fruit salad. This is what Sarah keeps on reminding me all the time. So, and speaking about the NGOs, I'm glad to be part of, to be invited to this lovely event by the Rotary Club of Beirut Cedars. I'm proud to know that about their food box projects, where around 18,000 hot meals were distributed, and 12,314 food boxes and 25 rice bags of 40 kilos were given to the needy people through the Peace Building and Conflict Prevention Project, which spent till now more than $265,600, to be accurate, because President Farah doesn't like that we don't use accurate numbers. But if we if you're really convinced that we need to do more, please, anybody who's in the room, let write on the chat the address of rcbeirutcedars.org/donate to make sure that those who are attending will have the address to use. To finish, I'll just remind you with I leave you with one or two videos, very quick ones. This video, it took more than 6 months to produce it. And I believe that you will enjoy it because it will explain the journey of the journey of one of the fruits that might end in a dustbin. I will skip the next video so that we don't waste a lot of your time. I will send you the link with the presentation, so that feel free to share it with anyone. I'm always available. Whoever wants to have another group chat, I'm ready to do it. And I can give you the documents I mentioned, the law related to the food waste, to the food donation in Lebanon, and the voluntary code of conduct on food waste that FAO has produced, if you just write to me to this email. I really thank you, and I'm ready to get your questions.
Thank you very much, Mr. Azouri, for this very instructive presentation, which appeals to the collective conscience. I strongly believe that it's everyone's responsibility to control and reduce food waste. I believe we can make a significant change by starting changing our habits in our homes and in society. Since what can be considered as a food waste for some might be the only and most important meal for the others. So without further ado, I will we'll start, the floor is now open for the Q&A session. So I would be grateful from the Rotarian and the distinguished guests who have a question, please to write it on the Q&A session. And our speaker, Mr. Azouri, will be very happy to answer them.
Mr. Ronful was saying, and Mr. Nabil Ronful was saying in the chat that the club should organize, should assist volunteers to organize themselves into effective groups and NGOs, and NGOs need credibility to succeed their mission. I believe that not all NGOs are not active, and not all NGOs are not credible. So I really believe that the civil society has a very important role to play. And I really encourage everyone to try to see what they can do. This is our country, and we don't have other options, frankly speaking. Did we get any questions, or if you may, that anybody in the floor, either write in the chat or...
Yes, we are starting receiving a question. So I will start with the first one. The food that has to be wasted can be put into the compost. At least it will be transformed into a resource. So what do you think about that?
I'm not an expert in what to do with food, but I should say before getting to the compost, we should really try everything. We should really try to use all ways. I know that 45% of fruits and vegetables are lost or wasted, because this is like the highest product that we lose. It's good to send it to the compost, but if we have a complete system about that, and I remember that your club was supposed to launch a compost project, but they couldn't do it through Zoom, because at the same year where this was discussed, and we had meetings even with FAO representative in Lebanon, we had coronavirus and the schools were literally unoperational. Anyway, anything we can do with the food without becoming a garbage. And I remember I had a meeting with a person who's in charge of one of these generating places using garbage. He said the Lebanese garbage is the most difficult to use for generating power, because it's full of organic products. So this answers our question. If we really manage to save on food waste and to send it to compost, then at least we can have less food and organic products in our landfills.
Thank you, Mr. Azouri. We'll be waiting a little bit for other questions. Otherwise, your presentation was extremely clear, straight to the point. I would like to ask a question. Who is to blame in the chain? The producer, the distributor, the consumer? Are we importing more items, or are we ordering more food than what we need? So who is mostly to blame?
The blame game is very dangerous, because if I want to blame, I can blame everyone, because everybody is looking to is looking for profit, and everybody thinks that what he's doing is profitable. I personally believe that we shouldn't. As consumers, our role starts when we buy the product. So let's work on our part. Buying the product, the basic thing, as Sarah, my daughter, says, don't go to the supermarket hungry, because you end up buying more than what you really need. Don't fall in the trap of special offers. I know that in Lebanon, we don't have special offers anymore. I mean, we barely have the food. So buy what you believe that you need and be creative. In the Netherlands, they have a special day every week where they eat the leftovers. There's one day that they don't cook. They eat everything that's left in the fridge. I should blame myself as a person who thinks, if I can afford to buy, it doesn't mean that I said it 2 years ago, I'm not paying for the cost of the food I'm buying. I'm paying for the trade value of the product that I'm buying. If you saw in the video of food is never waste, we said that the 100 billion tons of food that are thrown, they have a market value of $1 trillion. Although FAO says $400 million, we are talking about the retail value of what we're throwing. If I'm talking about, I want the consumer to be a wise consumer. If you are a wise consumer, to me, that's enough. If you are a responsible manufacturer, of course, when you make 20 tons of labneh and you expect to sell them, it's fine. But if you realize that at a certain stage that you didn't sell them all, try not to throw them. Try to use them wisely. Consider it CSR, charity, civic action, resistance, nationalism, whatever you call it. Everybody is responsible. And as Secretary General Guterres said, everybody has a role to play. And I know you are all grown-ups and you know exactly what you believe that's the best to do and what you can do.
Thank you for answering my question. I would like to add that you have some applications in France where you have suppliers or who are selling their stuff at who are, instead of wasting them, they are selling them at a low price, and there is a real market for it. So maybe a few days before the expiry date, so the people are coming and they are buying it at a very low and competitive price. Maybe it would be a good idea to launch such an idea or such an application in Lebanon. It will help many people, especially during this day. What do you think?
It's a global trend. There is an app in France that says that tells you which restaurant and which supermarket and which grocery store is now having things that are on discount. And there is a trend, I mean, here in Cyprus as well, and I've seen in other countries that, for example, some supermarkets, even in Lebanon, those that prepare like cooked food, they give a discount after 8 o'clock in the evening so that they don't throw the food away. And there is a supermarket in Germany that sells only products that are near expired products. The only product they sell are nearly expired, and they tell people because there is a difference between an expired product and between the expiry date and use by date. The expiry date is the expiry date where the product becomes not consumable, and the best by date, it still has the some nutritious value. It doesn't harm you if you consume it. So it's good to launch a national campaign, as Madame Giselle said in the chat, in the Q&A. You need to make a national campaign. I mean, it is our country. We need to use all the resources we have. I'm glad all the media who are present today, for example, if everybody tries to say, to create their own icon on their website or on their news media or on their TV channel or on their radio, a spot for free, telling them, don't throw your food. Make sure that you use it completely. Make sure that you donate around you. The Lebanese are creative. I mean, we are creative in good things and we're creative in not so good things. So let's focus on the positive side of it. I ask you to talk to the experts in Beritech. They always have these startups that and the young people who have ideas and they try to create them. It's good to monetize social activities, try to create a system out of this. I mean, I contributed to creating an app in Qatar called Accessible Qatar, because we were hosting a group of people with disabilities and somebody in Suwaif wanted to go to the toilets and nobody could locate an accessible WC. So the road is wide open to many activities, and we shouldn't throw any food in Lebanon. Now it's not the time. It's up to you to be creative and find a solution.
Thank you. I'm going to read the question and one by one, and you will answer me. So how can we convince consumers the value of foods, especially the food with low prices, and importance of not wasting it?
It's a very good question. We need it's a matter of trust. Very simple. If a supermarket puts on the shelves that these are nearly expired products, they will gain the trust of their consumers. If the grocery store made a special section, and every day they put a few things that supposed to be kind of leftovers, even if they make 10% discount. But don't fool people by just keeping these on the shelves and say, let's hope he won't see that it nearly expires. Because the problem is that sometimes you reduce the price without telling why, and people end up buying more products because they consider it as affordable, and they will end up dealing with an expired product. We need this transparency, and I believe anybody who can have access to any supermarket or any chain of supermarkets, let's make this national duty. Tell people this is nearly expired. It will expire in 2 weeks. Buy as much as you need or as you anticipate to use within the expiry date. And this will save us a lot of money, and it will save a lot of products that are not consumable. I hope that the answer is clear, and I'm trying to give practical answers, not just like theories.
We will pass to our next question. What recommendations would be made to assure safety of the donation on a family level who would like to avoid food waste at home?
It's a very tricky question, because sometimes we face this problem when we are having gross distribution, if we are distributing widely. The biggest safety, I believe, is to work with a very, very, very small group, distribute within 1 or 2 kilometers around you, so that we can touch to everyone. And like what the students are doing, they are going to each house, not just leaving a box or giving them the box without telling them what's in there. They are spending 5 minutes with them, telling them, we chose for you this and this and this and this product. Pay attention, this will expire in 2 weeks. This you can keep it for 3 days, especially now that we are having a real problem with the lack or absence of electricity. So that what we are used to keep for a week in a fridge can roughly stay for 1 or 2 days. So that's why we need to be precise and have the individual approach to those who are receiving. If we are having volunteers who are distributing, we will train them and tell the guys, please keep the rice for a week, but use this milk in 2 days. You'd better eat the eggs in 3 days. Let's consider that, I hate to say it, like we are one of the countries in the world that don't have electricity. I had once to give a presentation in the jungle where we don't have electricity. I didn't use PowerPoint, I used a flip chart. So let's consider that we don't have electricity in Lebanon, and whatever we distribute, it should be consumed immediately, unless we distribute the grains like rice and sugar and burghul, so that things will stay for a longer time. Don't count on electricity to spare to keep your fruits. Give smaller portions. I will give it to all. I will give this advice to all those who are distributing. Give smaller portions, taking in consideration that people might not have a place to keep them in a fridge. If we look at this from this perspective, I believe we will save a lot of the food that we are distributing. And I believe working on a small scale helps us all.
Thank you. We'll go to our next question. Sometimes food is not used for its intended purpose. And you mentioned that it can be managed in different ways, such as donation, to feed people, for example, the poor one, or for NGOs. So can we give it to animals? This is one. And the second, I think it's a way of management or a way to reduce food waste. But the most important is, how can we stop waste, especially at homes?
I hope Ms. Carol has seen the video of the strawberry, because what became waste at home started as an impulsive buying of something that was not on the list. And if you see the discussion between the mother and her daughter, it's done in, of course, thanks God, it's done in a European country, so she didn't hit her on or shout on her for asking for strawberries. So it started like this. Of course, giving it to animals is a good option, but let's be realistic. Giving it to animals, or giving it to or turning it into compost, should really be the last recourse. We are having hungry human beings in Lebanon, sorry to say it. We are having people who are hungry. Let's try to feed the people with the best possible way we can, the best possible way. And by the way, feeding the animals is not a very accurate way. I had an example in Egypt when they were creating fodder out of the leftovers. They realized, for example, that anything contaminated with meat should not be given to cows. So they had to split the fodder production line between cows and birds. I personally prefer, at this stage, at the crisis that we have in Lebanon, that we don't lose any food, that we don't waste any food. To be creative, even if, I don't know, you just take it in the car and go around you, and if you see somebody begging, or if you know someone, even a few blocks away, that a poor family. It's good to have this act of solidarity, not necessarily to invite the media and get the pictures and post it and have a selfie with them. I mean, we are talking, now I'm talking in a different tone than what I said 2 years ago, because now we have a crisis and people are hungry and people are not eating, many people are not eating 3 meals. And if people don't eat 3 meals a day, this will be a disaster at many levels.
Thank you.
I hope that I answered the question, Ms. Carol.
Yes, you answered very well. We'll go to our last question. Rather than creating a new ONG, or what would be better? It would be better to work with an existing one, or maybe what? How can we work in a better way? How to work with existing NGOs who are already well established? They know the people. They have. They know how to distribute it. So I believe this is the question of Mrs. Giselle Hajj. I think maybe she's trying to understand what can we do more.
I have nothing against NGO, and I have always supported many NGOs in my life, and I keep on supporting them, and I might create a few in the future. The bottom line, let's not waste food. And I said, be creative, be smart, be proactive. If you know a good NGO who has a good network and who's able to do it, it's fine. I believe NGOs can help in negotiating, if I would say, with the big companies, and so that we don't see milk thrown or milk hidden somewhere in a warehouse. I believe a good NGO, if they have a good distribution network, they can help in these type of things. You can have NGOs, you can be an anonymous group of people, you can be just people stay living in the same building. Just be creative. Whatever, wherever you live, whatever is your political affiliation, including none, whatever is your religious belief, including none, any person we can help in Lebanon, we are lessening the burden of the crisis. We are in a crisis. So be creative. I'm not calling for created NGOs. My only call is for not wasting food in any possible way you may think of.
Thank you. It was supposed to be our last question, but during when you were speaking, we received the last one. So I will ask it to satisfy this anonymous attendee. What about the huge waste in the restaurants, especially in Lebanon? And the Maza concept.
This is a very important question, and something happening everywhere. We have the Maza concept, and in other places we have the buffet. So it is a personal behavior. For example, I'll give an example. I'm in Cyprus. When we want to have fish meze, we make sure that we are three or four people, and we order a meze for two. Very easy. If we want to have a Lebanese meze, I know it's becoming something from the past for many of us, but we need to be selective and choose what we believe that we are able to eat. I know it's against our tradition. I know it's against the way we look at life, but part of it is to make sure that it's not thrown. Because let me put it this way, anything that stays on the table, it goes to garbage. Any restaurant that respects itself will not take the tabbouleh and add it again to make another tabbouleh. Although tabbouleh is a very vulnerable product, they can keep on adding it forever. I mean, for 1 or 2 days. I mean, some products are more difficult, but there are examples where you see sometimes the potato in the plate. So you can see that somebody has left a potato in a previous dish. So I'm just saying we need to be responsible. Eat meze. I mean, of course, don't quote me on that. Instead of eating meze, you can eat sushi. I mean, you can. Choose the product, it's definitely a bad joke. Choose exactly what you believe you are able to eat. I mean, if you go once in a month to a restaurant, decide this week what are you going to have, and the week after you decide on something else. I would really recommend that we use plates that we can finish. It's not even if we can afford to pay for it. This is the big problem we have. Say, yes, but I mean, it's my money, I'm paying it. It's not your money. You are paying a nominal value of something that has As our director general said, Mr. Kyudonyu, we need to respect the food, the work that was done. We need to forget about the meze, like the open meze, and try really to choose things that you don't do at home and to diversify what we eat, or to can invite more people, but order the same amount of dishes. These are the two feasible solutions. And let's not forget that we are in a crisis.
Thank you very much, Mr. Azouri, for this excellent presentation. And I leave the floor to our president, Roni Farah.
Thank you for this eye-opening session. I hope that we will get many requests from those who were listening to us. We will be putting it on YouTube, and they can see it and check what to do next. The last question I may ask is that we worked 2 years for the law 183 to see the light and to be voted. However, like every law, there is no application rules, and I haven't seen any. We don't know how to proceed after that. Many of our laws are voted and then put in a drawer, and we cannot use them. This is unfortunate, and we don't know how to proceed with a lack of parliamentarians really in looking to protect our environment or see that Lebanon goes forward. And that's why we are in the deep mess that we are in. Thank you again, Issam, for your time, for this valuable information that you gave us.
Thank you all, and good night.
So thank you very much. Thank you again, Mr. Azouri. So we'll be talking now our upcoming events. So it will be with our coach, Samir Elias Zahil, who will be talking about leadership best sacrosanct rules. It will be on October 20. So thank you very much for your time and your consideration, and looking forward to seeing you all on October 20. Good night.